recognizes, and they also are, when they were started about, they were 40th or 42nd in the list of the colleges. Now they have come in the top 10. Thing is, when you get student with 90%, you have a raw material, first rate. No, it is up to us how to work. And as earlier I said, last 15 years I've been working on education. One of the subjects is the education. We can easily bring these 50 or 60 colleges where the cutoff is 90 to IIT levels. No problem. And finally, I have given a target to the education ministry, which they have not accepted, that it will be possible for us, not too far distant future, within about 4 to 5 years, that we can produce 25,000 to 30,000 top engineers. And 6,000 doctorates of PhDs instead of 600. That should be our goal. And I think we need to do a gap analysis for every educational institution, even the IITs. I have been involved with the IIT Kanpur and IIT Bombay. And what we don't realize, that like the development of the student, faculty development is also very important. There should be collaboration between top engineering colleges and the IITs or triple IITs, and their curriculum should reflect current and advanced knowledge. As earlier I said, curriculum should be frequently reviewed to obviate obsolescence. Vacant faculty positions should be filled through regular appointment as well as adjunct. Give you example of the College of Engineering, Pune, which has undergraduate equivalent to IIT now. When we started, we had a faculty of 99, 10 PhDs. Today, we have a faculty of 205, 107 PhDs. So what we can do there, we can do all over the country. That's what I said, last 15 years I've spent partly on education and partly on other things. Now, there's one more thing that I want to share with you. That is that we should have some system for helping the students to meet their financial needs during the college. Abroad, it's very easy to get a bank loan to finance your education, and there's no reason why we can't do that in this country. And again, I want to stress the development of faculties, accretion to the faculties. The knowledge doesn't become obsolete, but there's much more knowledge coming round in every discipline. And of course, digital technology will become an infrastructure. But nonetheless, we have to create an environment where the faculty also wants to learn. And as I said, there is a need for continuing education. This country has a lot of problems. It has almost 100 million adult illiterates. Now, how do you? So there is a way to do it. We have shown it to the government. The government has taken. We have made about 300,000 people literate at the age of 25. What we have done, we have, after a lot of research, with the help of higher education people and IIT Bombay, that found that if you have knowledge of about 600 words in your mother tongue, you will be able to read the newspaper in your mother tongue. So that objective we have. We haven't got the in our objective to enable them to write. We think they should do it on their own. We have also not spent any time on number work for the reasons you give. Any illiterate 100 rupees, he keeps perfect account. So I have some problems with the government of India which they think they must learn writing, they must have number work. I said, don't waste time. Make him literate enough to read the newspaper. He becomes part of the country. And then he can take off from there whatever he wants. Now, at the end, I was addressing the graduating class. I would like to submit that the future will require courage, discipline, hard work, and some sacrifice. You will need vision to control your career and destiny. In this lies the destiny of our country and your future. I hope you will accomplish this. I wish you all the success in the future. Thank you.
I now request our Honorable Chairman, Board of Governors, to deliver his convocation address.
Padma Bhushan Sri Fakir Chandji Kohli, the Bhishma Pitama of the Indian software and the chief guest of the function today, Professor G.C. Nandi, Director of the Institute, members of the Senate and other governing bodies, distinguished guests, faculty members of the Institute, RDS students, and their family members, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you all to this very important event, the 11th convocation of this prestigious Center of Learning, the Indian Institute of Information Technology at Allahabad. I congratulate all the graduates who will be receiving their degrees and awards and wish them all the best in their future endeavors. I have had the honor to be the chairman of your institute for less than 3 months. Recently, I made a two-day trip here to familiarize myself with the various activities of the institute. I went around all the facilities. I interacted with the faculty, the staff, the students, and your director, Professor Nandi, in separate meetings. I would like to share with you very briefly my initial and preliminary impressions and observations, even though most of you may be aware of most of these facts. We are located in an excellent campus with world-class facilities and laboratories. With a little effort, we can surely enhance the look and feel and the usefulness of the premises that we are in. The interaction with the faculty was very illuminating and encouraging. There is a great desire to create centers of excellence in select areas to make the institute known around the world. The staff is equally eager to participate in bringing about such a change. The students, who are the very reason for the existence of the institute, express their appreciation of what they are learning here and express their desire to participate in this journey. In short, therefore, we have all the ingredients to achieve our goals, for which we all need to work collectively, putting our hands together and sharing our thoughts and ideas. We also need to create an environment of transparency, equity, fair play, and mutual trust. I can assure you that the board on its part will only encourage and look forward to receiving ideas and views from all sections within as well as from well-wishers outside the institute. It would participate in laying down strategic direction as well as in guiding the implementation of the plan to make IIIT Allahabad the leader and benchmark in creating and disseminating knowledge within information technology sector. In the board meeting held yesterday, the board has suggested that the two deans representing the faculty on the board would make a white paper on this, how to make centers of excellence and make this a world-class institution. They will, of course, discuss with everybody concerned, with the network outside India and within India, and come up with suggestions for discussions at the board level. As information technology acquires an increasingly critical and pervasive role in transforming India, IIIT Allahabad must become a facilitator and catalyst in shaping this transformation. It must align itself to the direction and goals set by the government and lend its weight to help the nation to respond to the challenges and in creating a fair, transparent, an equitable system encompassing all sections of the society. One of the key enablers to achieve these goals is to acquire financial independence and strength. This can only happen if we do things which are relevant, contemporary, and sufficiently differentiated and unique to make people become interested in us. This will enable us to attract the skills and knowledge from far corners of the world on temporary and permanent assignments, and equally expose our existing talent to the best in their area, and thus create a symbiotic relationship in this increasingly networked world. We must market ourselves well to attract endowments and financial grants for projects and assignments. In today's world, raising money is an extremely important aspect which educational institutes need to actively pursue and create the necessary orientation and a structure to achieve it. In a recent IIIT Council meeting chaired by the Honorable HRD Minister, he clearly challenged and tasked the IIITs to stand on their own feet in 5 years' time and not continue to keep looking to the government for sustenance and growth. I would very much urge the growing universe of alumni to take a leading role in this challenge and urge the alumni community to stay connected with the alma mater and play an active part in both creating the template for institute to become a world-class institution and to have the means to accomplish it. The institute on this part should make necessary steps to create a vibrant and healthy relationship with the alumni and invite them to participate in creating a blueprint for the future. Finally, I would like to thank you all for being here in such a short period of time. I would like to particularly thank Mr. Kohli to be acceding very easily to our request to be the chief guest. For those who don't know, in spite of his years, you may not know that Mr. Kohli is over 90 years of age, but he's, as you can see, he's in fit health, and God bless him to remain so. And in spite of an extremely hectic schedule, as you learned from his speech, that he's so very actively involved, he did not hesitate even for a minute to come here, as he is so much passionate about education that he kind of exceeded in spite of everything, and he's here with us. So thank you very much, sir, for being with us. I would also like to thank the director and all the faculty, all the colleagues and everybody here in the institute to make it possible to have the convocation here in spite of such a short notice. And what we have decided is in the future we will set a date for the convocation, which will happen every year on that particular date or dates. I would like to congratulate once again the graduates and the award winners and wish them all the best in their future endeavors. Thank you all.